Is the MacBook Pro actually good for machine learning? Let's find out. This video is sponsored by Skillshare. Welcome back to the hardware series. This is going to be the first of two videos where we actually get to play with some hardware, first from the software perspective and then from the actual touching hardware perspective. We're going to start with the M1 chip that is in the new 2020 MacBooks, mostly because I have one, but also because there was a lot of hype when the M1 chip originally was announced, since it was designed to actually process things that required machine learning a lot faster than most standard chips that you see in computers. So I thought it would be fun to essentially do a benchmarking video where we actually try out the M1 chip and compare it to standard computer CPUs as well as normal GPUs like Tesla V100s and ideally also a TPU if I can get my hands on it. If you want to check out the rest of the hardware series, I'll include the playlist up in the cards, and you should subscribe and turn on your post notifications so that you can see the last video in this series, as well as so that you can follow the NLP series, which I'll be doing next month, which will focus on natural language processing from things like recurrent neural networks to transformers and GPT-3. So before we dive into code, let's talk a little bit about what makes the M1 chip different from things like the standard Intel chips that you normally find in MacBook Pros. The M1 chip was designed specifically for Apple computers, and interestingly enough, it's actually cheaper to produce than the Intel chips were for Apple to acquire, which makes the M1 computers a lot cheaper than the standard models of most Apple computers. One of the more interesting things about it is that unlike some other computer architectures, which we've talked about in other videos, where things like your processor and your memory are separate chips that need to be connected and which introduce things like latency because we have to take that extra time to go to that other chip and collect information before we can process it somewhere else. On the M1 chip, all of those things are on the same place, on the same chip, which lets you process information and execute instructions and run programs a lot faster. And I should say now, if you want to really deep dive onto the M1 chip and Apple in general, you should go check out Rene Ritchie's channel. He does great in-depth videos on all of this stuff. And if you want even deeper dives, you should check him out on Nebula. But in short, the M1 chip allows for much faster processing of most things because you don't have to go as far to access things like memory, because the memory and the processor are all on the same chip. On top of that, there's also an 8-core GPU on the M1 chip, which in short allows you to run video games with less latency and generally process graphics a lot faster than you would otherwise. And then, of course, why I was interested in making this video, the M1 chip features a 16-core neural engine, which is specifically designed to optimize things that require machine learning, or more specifically, things that require a lot of matrix multiplication. And because of that, I wanted to see exactly how much better the M1 chip was, or wasn't, at running fairly simple machine learning models. So I ran a bunch of code and we'll go through the results now. So I was originally inspired to make this video based on a weights and biases report that someone wrote up a couple months ago that looked to run a similar benchmark. So this video is a bit of an extension of that work, but I want to mention that now just to give credit to the person who wrote that because they did an awesome job of an initial benchmark. Additionally, if you're curious about running something like this yourself, I've included a collab notebook in the description with the code that I used to run everything. You'll see the base code is essentially the same, but there were certain things that I had to tweak a little bit to accommodate for different requirements for things like TPUs and especially for the M1 chip, which I'll get into after we go through the actual performance. Starting off with things like accuracy loss, validation loss, I ran each model for 10 rounds and compared their outcomes. And so you can see that in most cases, things like accuracy loss, validation accuracy are fairly similar once you hit 10. This isn't super surprising. This was an MNIST model trained on a relatively complex network for the problem. So I intentionally designed a problem that I thought would be relatively easy for a model to solve. So I wouldn't have to worry as much about making comparisons when one model barely performed and another one knocked it out of the park. But getting onto something a little bit more interesting, we can look essentially at the system logs for each of these runs. And so what we're comparing here is M1 GPU only, M1 eager mode, and a V100, so a Tesla V100 GPU run. GPU only is something that you have to force the M1 chip to do. By default, it goes into eager mode, which essentially allows the OS behind your computer to figure out what the optimal distribution of tasks across the GPU and CPU are. And when I ran those trials, I found that the computer predominantly relied on the CPU, so I wanted to see what would happen if I ran everything on the GPU instead. And interestingly, what you can see here is that the V100 is still a better GPU in effect. This is because it actually has more processing power than the M1 chip has. So if we start by looking at these three graphs on the top, we can see that the Tesla V100 generally uses more power overall, but completes our training task in much less time. This isn't super surprising, mostly because running this through Collab and running it through a Tesla V100, you have access to more power than you do through a laptop. Interestingly, you can also see that although the power usage as a percentage is higher for the V100, the actual percentage of memory allocated is lower for the V100 compared to the M1 chip. This isn't super surprising, which we'll get to in the next row of graphs, because if you look at the GPU utilization, you'll see that in general for the M1 chip, we're using basically all of our GPU resources to train this model. And as I mentioned earlier, because the heat tolerance of this laptop is lower, it generally stays at a relatively consistent temperature, slightly above room temperature, which isn't super surprising because if it were to get hotter than that, we'd have a problem. As a quick aside, we can also talk a little bit about training time. So the four comparisons that I'm making here are the M1 GPU only, the M1 in eager mode, a Tesla V100, and a Collab CPU, so a Collab running without any sort of hardware acceleration. The V100 trained this model in just over a minute, whereas the M1 in eager mode took about 5 minutes to make it through all 10 rounds, and the M1 in GPU only mode actually took longer, which I thought was interesting. That wasn't something I necessarily expected. My guess is that when I specifically limit the model to the GPU, it also kicks out the neural engine, which is likely allowing the eager mode to actually run faster. Interestingly, if you look at CPU utilization, you'll see that the utilization for eager mode is actually below the utilization for GPU only. This is likely because in eager mode, you're not actually building the graph associated with the network to run it. And I'll be doing a video on graph neural networks in the next month or so, so stay tuned for an explainer on that. But essentially, building a graph takes time and CPU processing power. And so we're likely using up more of the CPU for that. And then as we build the graph, we can see that kind of go back down to something comparable to the M1 chip. On the other hand, if you look at the Collab version where we don't use any sort of hardware acceleration, you can see that we're basically using the entire CPU the entire time, which makes sense. And that in the V100 version, we're initially using a lot of the CPU. This is likely in the initial setup of our model, collection of data, things like that. And then as we actually train our model, you can see that drop pretty sharply down to about 50%, because at that point, everything's being offloaded to the GPU. We don't need the CPU as much anymore. So if you'd like to do a deeper dive into the actual results, I'll link the report that I made in Weights and Biases for this. But in short, the M1 chip, especially if you use it in eager mode, which is the default setting, actually does speed up the processing time a lot compared to especially no hardware acceleration. You go from something on the order of 25 minutes runtime to around 5 minutes, which is definitely a great improvement. So if I were to look at this information without the broader context of the work that goes into running things on cloud servers or on M1 laptops or on something without hardware acceleration, I would probably say that the M1 Macs are actually a pretty good machine learning resource, especially for someone who isn't necessarily doing something like research and development at an industry level. I think that if you're working at somewhere like Google, you're probably still going to use cloud servers to run your models, because anything you're running is going to be too big for a laptop anyway. But when it comes to actually running and playing with models on your laptop, installing TensorFlow for Mac is a whole ordeal. In fact, if you follow me on Twitter, you probably saw me tweet that I spent 4 hours trying to figure out how to install this correctly. And that was 4 hours as someone who's fairly familiar with weird and complicated installations of software that isn't particularly mainstream or might still be in beta. So if you're new to machine learning and it's something that you're looking to get into and you're thinking about an M1 MacBook Pro because you think it'll be a way to learn faster, I wouldn't necessarily recommend it for that, because the learning curve for installing TensorFlow for Mac is steep. Having said that, because it's such a new system, I would expect that by the time the next version of M1 chips comes out, likely this summer, that we'll see more established setups so that this whole installation process isn't such a pain. So now that we've looked at all those results, is this laptop actually good for machine learning? Well, I think my answer would be not really, at least not yet. The M1 system is useful for programs that have been developed to optimize the chip itself. Things like Pixelmator Pro or Final Cut, which are designed to take advantage of the resources that the chip offers. However, most programs aren't actually optimized for the M1 chip yet and instead use a system called Rosetta, which essentially allows them to run as normal on M1 computers, but don't take advantage of any of the optimization. Additionally, installing the required libraries to actually do machine learning on the M1 Max is non-trivial. The main current system is Tensorflow for macOS, which allows you to use ML Compute, the library that allows you to actually use the optimization that comes with the M1 chip. It's still in the process of being developed. It's effectively in beta, so it's still a little bit buggy. There are still some confusing issues with it. It can only run on certain versions of Python, and you have to make sure that the version of Python that you're running on is actually optimized for use with the M1 chip. There are a lot of things that you have to figure out in the process of installing this, and while a combination of prior knowledge and Stack Overflow got me through, I could certainly see this being challenging for anyone who is new to command line programming. Plus, the power of the M1 chip is limited. It's not a cloud GPU, something like a Tesla V100, and so you can't necessarily run large models on this or train large models on this because you'd likely run into memory errors. In short, I'm certainly looking forward to playing more with the M1 chip and seeing how much I can push it, what I can use it for. Apple's been developing this interesting developer program for machine learning people, so there's been a lot of great releases that can help you do more machine learning on things like your phone or your laptop, and hopefully I'll be making videos about that in the future. But as a research and development system, if you're interested in machine learning research, I'd say it's definitely a step in an interesting direction. As we've talked about, new computer architectures have been of particular interest to the machine learning research community because we're running up against that compute barrier for most standard systems. But I don't think that you're going to be running something like GPT-3 on this anytime soon. In the meantime, using M1 chip optimized software like DaVinci Resolve has helped me get started on one of my goals for 2021, doing more YouTube shorts, TikToks, and Instagram reels, because I can render videos way faster than I used to be able to. Of course, that's not all that goes into vertical video. I also had to learn how to make good vertical videos, and one of the things that actually has been helping me a lot is this course on Skillshare, on telling an engaging story for Instagram in less than a minute. In fact, I recently posted a video on all three platforms after taking the course, and the tips has helped it reach way more of you than it would have otherwise. If this sounds interesting to you, you should join Skillshare, an online learning community for creatives where millions come together to take the next step in their creative journeys for less than $10 a month. They offer thousands of inspiring classes for creative and curious people, so if vertical video isn't your thing, you can explore topics including illustration, design, photography, video, freelancing, and more. Skillshare is curated specifically for learning, so there's no ads, and they're always launching new premium classes, like Thomas Frank's course on productivity and creativity. In fact, I make a guest appearance in one of the bonus videos for that course, so head on over and check it out. Skillshare members get unlimited access to thousands of inspiring classes with hands-on projects and feedback from a community of millions, and most classes are under 60 minutes with short lessons to fit any schedule. So if you'd like to support my channel and develop your creative skills this year, you can click on my link in the description to join Skillshare. In fact, the first 1,000 of my subscribers to use my link in the description will get a free trial of Skillshare premium membership so that you can check out that interview I did with Thomas and explore your creativity.